Investor Connect podcast program. This is Hall T. Martin. I'm the host of the show, in which we interview angel investors, venture capital, private equity, family offices, and many other investor groups for startups and growth companies. I hope you enjoy this episode. Thank you for joining us. Well, hello, this is Hall Martin with Investor Connect. Today we're here with Wayne Wu of VMG Partners. Wayne, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Can you talk a little bit about your background and what led you into early stage investing?
VMG, it was kind of serendipity how I ended up at VMG. I guess it's close to 12 years ago. I was a CFO of an auto retail group. So essentially what we did was we owned and operated franchise car dealerships. And previous to that, I was in investment banking at RBC Capital Markets. And I decided that I wanted to combine the operating experience and investment experience that I had through investment banking into one role, which was an operations focused private equity investment fund. And I went to go seek out a career in that. And I had seen the power of brands in the automotive industry. I think it's one of the biggest badges that people carry around. They either overplay it in some way or underplay it in others as a reflection of themselves. And believe it or not, I end up actually meeting one of the co-founders of VMG through a conference network called Association for Corporate Growth, aka ACG. And there's a San Francisco chapter where when you get admitted into the chapter, you make a speech and introduce yourself. And I made a speech in front of at a luncheon of 200 people. I said, I'm Wayne Wu, I'm CFO of this automotive company, et cetera, et cetera. But having said that, I'm looking to transition into an investment role at a private equity firm. If anyone's interested in my background, please let me know. And as I walked off the stage, one of the co-founders handed me her business card. And from there, I ended up becoming one of the first hires in VMG history. So this was at the end of, this was Q4 of 2007. VMG had just closed on its final close of its first fund, a $325 million fund, the largest first-time consumer fund ever raised. And I had the great fortune of joining as the first junior hire of this tremendously entrepreneurial venture of a startup consumer fund.
Great. It sounds like you got in quite early compared to other investors into the consumer world itself. But for those who are investing in the space, what would you advise them to look for as they come into this consumer space?
In terms of investors or someone seeking to become an investor, could you clarify the question?
So someone that wants to be an angel investor or a venture capital investor, and they're now entering the consumer space, they may have invested somewhere else or they may not invest at all, and they're now coming into the space, what advice do you give them about investing in this space?
Yeah, a few things. One, don't extrapolate your own personal taste profile onto what would be a good consumer investment. And I think that's the nature of the beast, where if you're investing in energy companies, you have less of a tendency or ability to extrapolate your own personal viewpoints on certain things, rather be a bit more of an objective investor. And I think in the consumer space, because of the nature of all of us being consumers ourselves, but then if you're investing in the consumer space, make sure that you're making an objective decision based on an investment thesis that goes beyond whether you like the product or not. And then secondarily, really just think about where, not only where trends are going, but also how people are buying things. I think really focus on incremental change, not step function change. I think there's a dynamic where folks believe necessarily that suddenly everything's going to necessarily maybe be bought direct to consumer online, or people are going to move from eating Cheetos to cricket flour bars. Neither of those things happen overnight. Both are moving more towards those types of directions, but it's incremental as opposed to a step function change.
So what is VMG Partners' investment thesis? Specifically, what are you looking for in the consumer space with your current fund? And what gets you excited out there as far as sectors or stages?
Yeah, so we are the largest fund focused solely in branded consumable products. So we invest in branded food and beverage, personal care, beauty, pet food, pet treats, and then the wellness supplement space. So as much as we define what we invest in, it's also what we don't. We don't invest in retail, restaurants, private label manufacturers, or even branded hard good or lifestyle items. So we don't invest in apparel, footwear, things that you would find like coolers, et cetera. Really things that are higher frequency of purchase items. And in terms of size and stage, as a result of the narrowness of the categories we invest in a pretty wide range of stage. So it's really anything past proof of concept. So we'll invest in brands sub 5 million of revenue with a sub $5 million check size in terms of investment. And we've also invested in brands that have over a couple hundred million of revenue with, you know, a $200 million check. So for us, the core thesis is around branded consumable products, currently founder run or highly founder involved businesses that are where our thesis is around growth in terms of growing the company. We're not turnaround investors where we're trying to extract costs or drive our return through putting debt or leverage on the business. It's around building iconic brands at the end of the day and changing incrementally what consumers put in and on their bodies.
Well, it seems like the CPG space, consumer product goods space, is evolving rapidly. How do you see it evolving in the next 12 to 24 months? What do you think is going to be coming up that gets you excited?
What's interesting is you have a number of different dynamics at play. You have the continued consolidation of the strategic buyers. So think seeing Tyson buying Keystone Foods. You saw Pepsi this week buy SodaStream for over $3 billion. You're seeing Campbell's had bought Snyder's-Lance, and now they're thinking about breaking it apart. You have the continued dynamic of the Kraft Heinz consolidation. So you have the big getting bigger, but then also needing to match that with where the consumer is going at the end of the day and in terms of where they buy their products and what products they're buying. So they're consolidating to become bigger, to take conventional brands and drive costs out of them, but at the same time, starting and acquiring better for you brands to help drive growth for these large conglomerates and matching where the consumer is going.
How do you see direct-to-consumer playing into it, innovation in the actual distribution? It seems like everyone's shifting a little bit away from retail to online, Amazon and others leading the way, but where do you see that fitting into the investment thesis?
We're trying to match where the consumer is and where the consumer is going. So again, it's about incremental change. We don't believe that the consumer is ready today to buy everything online. They buy a portion of their products online and they buy a portion of their products in store. So our investment thesis is to match that. For example, we have brands that are 100% direct to consumer, such as Daily Harvest, which is really reinventing a plant-based both snacking and on the go, but also meal occasion through their smoothies and harvest bowls. And then you have traditional retail brands that grew within the store, like our sparkling water brand, Spindrift, that I have in my hand right now, that is sparkling water with just a tiny bit of fruit juice in there for flavor. And so consumers are still buying things in an omni-channel basis. And we seek to build omni-channel brands, meaning brands that are both online and off, and not taking a very extreme approach to it. Again, really focusing on this theme of incremental change.
And what do you see as the challenges for startups in the consumer product space? What unique challenges do you see they face compared to other startups that they have to navigate?
I think it's an interesting time where I think there's a question for brands of, do they start online or offline? As it relates to natural organic food, beverage, and wellness brands, we had an era where Whole Foods Market was a relatively decentralized entity where they could get, where entrepreneurs could get their start in a handful of Whole Foods Market stores, get into a particular region, and then eventually go national. As Whole Foods is, like the natural organic industry as a whole, has matured into more of another phase in its growth through centralization, et cetera, there's been less of an opportunity for some of these brands to grow at a very local level. So I think we're going through a transitionary time period where brands have to think about, do they continue to start hyper-local in the brick and mortar world, or do they start either direct to consumer on Amazon, or do they do all of the above? I think it's a tremendous time to be starting a new consumer brand, but with lots of different interesting choices to be made on how they go to market.
Which particular sector do you think is one of the better opportunities out there? There's many like meat replacements and premium alcohol seem to be getting a lot of traction out there with investors. But what other sectors do you get excited about?
I think one thing to note before we get into sectors is our approach. Our approach is to focus on the micro versus the macro. And what I mean by that is we believe that the right way to go about making investments is to take an ecosystem approach. And what I mean by that is we look and we only play in a very small handful of categories. And each of them has its own respective ecosystem. And what we want to do is to be the most supportive investor to the broader ecosystem. We may have 10 to 20 portfolio companies at a given time, but we want to help support hundreds and thousands of entrepreneurs within that respective ecosystem from very small, knowing that the likelihood is for most of them will never make an investment necessarily in them, nor do we have the hubris to think that they necessarily want us. But support those brands, those retailers, those distributors, and the whole flywheel that makes that go around, and learn about them over time. Where we naturally end up making an investment in them, then we think about it as dating to marriage as opposed to eloping, which we think makes for more successful investments. So as a result, we end up with a portfolio where we've become the most active investor in the nutritional bar space over the last 10 years. We did not have a thesis around that we were going to be the largest bar investor over the last year, but we looked, and by getting to know all of the entrepreneurs within the food space, we inevitably meet a number of bar entrepreneurs. And each one we meet them go, oh, seems to be doing something interesting. And each time they tell us something more interesting's happened. And then we end up investing in Kind, Quest, Perfect Bar, Health Warrior, Nature's Bakery, and Vega had their bars too. Now, we could have said, and then you back into the fact that the real theme that's happening is on-the-go snacking, protein supplementation, less sit-down meals. But if we had formed a thesis around that, we might have chosen the wrong brands. A lot of investors form a thesis around, we want to be in plant-based or some other theme. And they just start working their way down a list, and you end up with potentially a C or D level asset. We're focused on finding A level assets with awesome entrepreneurs who have potential with our help to become iconic brands. And we don't focus so much on portfolio mix or certain trends that we have to be a part of. We find that we end up seeing a trend happen within our portfolio through the micro dynamics that have led to us making investments.
Well, that's great. As an investor, what do you see as the primary risk in investing in this space? What are you trying to mitigate as you go into these opportunities?
One of the trends that you're seeing happening is both entrepreneurs and newer investors in this space are investing in opportunities that are a little niche. So two specific small market size, where the biggest, even if you own 100% of said market, you don't end up with a very big company that is self-sustaining in nature without need for further capital raising. So you end up something very niche. And then it's often paired up with the same theme of this podcast again, where it's a little too far ahead of itself, where it's driving towards a step function change instead of an incremental change. And you see, by definition, it ends up being a very small niche category because the consumer at the end of the day just isn't ready for it yet.
I've seen that many cases where we get out ahead of ourselves a little bit and the market's just not quite there. But so I can appreciate that sentiment for sure. So in the final few minutes that we have here, what else should we cover that we haven't?
I think what we have is a very, from terms of a, from a VMG standpoint, our focus is supporting an ecosystem. We want to be part of building community and driving thought leadership in this space. And a big part of that includes our own podcast. So we have our podcast, Unfinished Biz. My partner, Robin, and I host it. And the whole concept behind why we decided to launch a podcast was we found that many entrepreneur-based podcasts were very retrospective in nature, looking back at a journey that has already kind of, in a way, come to a conclusion and describing it in a way that is very much as rainbows and unicorns when there's really hard challenges that entrepreneurs go through and currently go through. So the whole thesis is around entrepreneurs that are still in the thick of it, where there's very relatable stories for aspiring entrepreneurs within the CPG space to see that what appears to be a very successful entrepreneur who's still going through it, they go through the same challenges too. And they can find that on the website unfinishedbiz.com or searching for Unfinished Biz on the podcast app of their choice. And I think that's one of the resounding themes of the emerging brand community that I've found to be different than other industries is how supportive everybody is of each other. And as entrepreneurs and investors are starting up in this space, go talk to folks. People are very open to sharing their own successes and failures and experiences in this space, which makes it it honestly invigorates me every morning to be able to do that. So there's no reason to ever go at it alone, investing or starting a company in the consumer space. There's someone who's going through something similar, have been through something similar. Go find them. You'll find that they're very open to speaking to you.
It is very communal in this space. In the very early stages, there's always a lot of sharing of information and building up the network. So it's always great to feel that energy inside the network. So it's great to have that. So how best for the audience to get back in touch with you?
Literally reach out to us. You mean my email address is wu@vmgpartners.com. I am a very, I guess, active is a probably an understatement in terms of my LinkedIn activity. I love LinkedIn, but I don't use LinkedIn messaging, so just email me. And then we literally respond to every email that comes through. Because again, it's all about this whole fundamental basis around supporting a broader ecosystem of people. So reach out to me. I'd love to help or have one of my colleagues help you out as well. So reach out.
Well, appreciate your show today. Looking forward to having you come back and let's give an update in the near future about how things are going. And with that, we'll close it out.
Awesome, Hall. Well, thanks for having me on the show.
Investor Connect helps investors interested in startup funding. In this podcast series, experienced investors share their experience and advice. You can learn more at investorconnect.org. Altie Martin is the director of Investor Connect, which is a 501c3 nonprofit dedicated to the education of investors for early stage funding. All opinions expressed by Hall and podcast guests are solely their own opinions and do not reflect the opinion of Investor Connect. This podcast is for informational purposes only and should not be relied upon as a basis for investment decisions.